Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My co-host today is Joan Willshire. We'll catch up to her in a minute. My special guest today would be Mai Thor from Disability Justice. She's going to talk to us about a whole bunch of things on there, the 10 points, important points of disability justice. And a little footnote to that, we're going to have probably a segment built into the show discussing each one of those points in future shows. So please stay tuned to Disability Viewpoints. Joan, who's your guest today?
Guthrie Byard, the brand new community specialist of the city of Minneapolis. It's an exciting story, so I can't wait to interview him and get all the good information about why the city hired him.
I'm excited, too, and then Joan is always where the action is. So it'll be an exciting half hour. We'll be back with more Disability Viewpoints right after this. Stay tuned, please.
The city of Minneapolis is investing in accessibility by hiring its first community specialist just for people with disabilities. And with me today is that person, Guthrie Byard. Welcome.
Thank you, Joan.
Why do you think it is so significant, though, in general?
I think that they realized that it was really important that they have somebody dedicated to being an advocate with people with disabilities and really being that arm of transparency for the city.
Sure.
And somebody that is really bringing forward not only individuals with disabilities, but their perspectives through all aspects of the city's programs and services.
Right.
And, you know, my predecessor was the ADA and language access coordinator, and the city decided to really ensure that there was a full-time language access coordinator as well as somebody managing
right.
Title II of the ADA. And so then that's when I came on board about 3 months ago to be that person who is essentially the ADA Title II designee
right.
in the form of a community specialist for people with disabilities.
Right. Well, that makes sense, too, because the hearing end of interpreters certainly needed a full-time person as well. So a lot of good things happened with this last budget round and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
And what department does your position fall within the city?
Yeah, so I work within the Department of Neighborhood and Community Relations.
Okay.
Yep. And we're located at the Crown Roller Mill Building, which is in in downtown Minneapolis.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, it's about four blocks away from City Hall.
Sure.
It's right off the river at the start
right.
of the St. Anthony Bridge, so
okay.
the Stone Arch
and
Bridge.
And will that be your permanent office, or will you be moving back into the city?
Yeah, it's anticipated that we'll be back in the city after renovations are complete sometime either late 2024 or 2025. It's still a bit uncertain
okay.
right now. Yeah.
Okay, well, that's fantastic. Well, let's talk about what exactly are you going to be doing?
Yeah. So expectations for me, one, are to not only be that staff contact
mm-hmm.
for the Minneapolis Advisory Committee on People with Disabilities that you've been on for
right.
many years, but also to lead the city's update to their ADA action plan. So, you know, a lot of folks might be familiar with an ADA transition
right.
plan that really
right.
details physical accessibility requirements and improvements
right.
To transition away from inaccessibility and non-compliance. The ADA action plan is really kind of more of an all-encompassing document. So it does
okay.
reference our city's ADA transition plan, which is really managed by our Public Works Department, as well as our Finance and Property Services Department that manages all city-owned properties.
Ah.
But the ADA action plan falls under my role and under my department to really ensure that we are managing Title II compliance across all programs and services,
mm-hmm.
as well as policies and procedures.
Sure.
So thinking about closed captioning, thinking about ensuring that interpreters are available, that there's a process
right.
for communicating that, and that if folks need to make that request for any internal or public meetings or events, that they have that process to be able to do that, so we're not overlooking any sort of
sure.
inaccessibility within our programs and services. And so all of that is encompassed within that ADA action plan that is updated now every other year or so. And so now it's our turn to kind of update that again.
Okay.
And so that was a big reason for my role, is to really have somebody dedicated to doing that every
right.
other year, in addition to being that community specialist where I'm bringing in more voices, bringing in more people on the advisory committee, things like that.
Right. Well, and it seems like for many cities, that is where there isn't much focus on. Mm-hmm. Everybody has to do an ADA transition
right.
plan, but many cities don't. They neglect it because there isn't a designated person. It's usually attached to someone's
exactly.
job description, mm-hmm. which means it's a great opportunity to either procrastinate or to just not do it at all, right?
That's correct. Yeah, a lot of cities will have like a transit planner where it'll be their
right.
add-on. But I think what the city of Minneapolis is really committed to is that, again, they have a dedicated person in this
mm-hmm.
role who is looking not just at physical accessibility compliance, but again, programmatic and policy compliance across the city. And so there's a unique opportunity here to be really at the forefront of
exactly.
governmental agencies, municipal
mm-hmm.
Agencies, to ensure that they are fully transparent and are more accessible than I think historically they have been. And that's not only with the advisory committee and ensuring
mm-hmm.
that those voices are heard, that there's actual impact with
sure.
the input that they're providing and the feedback that they're sharing. But that we're also seeing more staff who identify as having disabilities
sure.
and that they're in leadership positions, that they have opportunities to not only get in the door, but to advance in the organization and feel comfortable in sharing their full selves.
Sure.
And that's a big component of my work as well.
Right, right. So with your knowledge, I'm sure that will really help the other departments. I think that's been a longstanding issue from what we've been able to see as committee members.
So we've got our public works department that primarily will manage like sidewalk accessibility
right.
issues, things like
mm-hmm.
that, and I'll help advise on that. But any other ADA Title II complaints that might come in
mm-hmm.
Or in collaboration with our Title III liaison around business compliance and things like that,
right.
I am the go-to person with that. And so one of the things that I enjoy most about my job so far is actually going out into the community and meeting with
fabulous.
Residents at their apartment complex or their
okay.
Their favorite restaurant or something like that where
sure.
there's accessibility concerns, and actually talking through those issues with them on site in addition to whoever the property management company is
mm-hmm.
or the business owner is, and really building those
okay.
relationships and being that face for the city and getting away from the desk.
Right.
I like to be away from
yes.
the desk as much
yes.
as possible.
Yes, who doesn't?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yep.
And so will you work with the city inspections department along with some of the architectural barriers and so forth?
Yes, yep, and really understanding code compliance and awareness of Minnesota Accessibility Code, of ADA
right.
design standards, and building those relationships is really important so that when it falls out of the purview of my work, I have key people that I can go
to. You can
bring
on.
So that's also an important aspect of my role, is that I really want to be somebody who's helping to make things occur faster, not rush things,
right,
but have things happen more fluidly
right.
and faster so that people realize that the city
right.
can respond in a more
right.
effective way.
Okay. Now, let's quickly talk about the committee. How many members there are, how people get appointed to it, and
yeah.
so forth.
Yeah, so the interesting thing with this committee goes back to 1976. It's been around for a very long
mm-hmm.
time. And there's up to 15 seats on the committee. Right now we're at 11 seats, so there's
mm-hmm.
four vacancies. Folks can certainly reach out to me directly, and I'm happy to give my contact information. Otherwise, if they look up the Minneapolis Advisory Committee on People with Disabilities for the City of Minneapolis, they'll get access to the webpage for that advisory committee and a link to apply. And they can submit their application. I will review it. And they'll be invited to attend an upcoming
sure.
advisory committee meeting just to see if it's something that they're interested
in. And when are their meetings?
Their meetings are once a month on the third Wednesday of every month from 4:30 to 6:30 in the afternoon.
And in person, I know we've been doing kind of a hybrid.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so it's currently still hybrid. Most people attend virtually, but there is the opportunity to attend in person at City Hall along with myself if they're interested.
Room 132?
Room 132, yep. And so there's a couple of different ways that folks can participate in a way that mm-hmm. they feel comfortable. And as I mentioned, there's four vacancies right now, so people are certainly welcome to apply right now.
Great.
And the interesting thing with this committee is that they're all mayoral appointees. And so myself in my office, we would recommend an individual mm-hmm. that gets to the mayor's office, and then they go through the approval process. So they'll review the application, presumably approve that individual, and then all of those positions are appointed by the mayor's office for staggered two-year terms. Again, there's, I think, a lot of influence that this committee provides. There's a lot of impact and potential for this committee ongoing.
Right.
And being mayorally appointed, I think that shows that it's extremely important committee for the city.
Well, and I know in the past we'll do some plan reviews with architects, buildings. I know building construction is slowed down a little bit, mm-hmm. but when new things come in, or even renovations, the committee will get involved to say what works, what doesn't work, and so forth.
Yep.
Now, let's talk a little bit before we have to end about the recent elections mm-hmm. and new city council members and how to interact with them and thoughts and guidance on those issues.
Yeah. Well, first off, I encourage anybody in the city, disability or not, to be mm-hmm. connecting with their city council members. So those who were mm-hmm. reappointed, those who are new to the city, to establish a relationship with your city council member, that's extremely important. And really one of the aims for me as being a staff contact for the Advisory Committee on People with Disabilities is ensuring that those committee members are connecting with their city council members as well.
Exactly.
Because as it's important for the committee to be talking about issues, to be a leader on those issues and promoting them through my role in my department, it's also important that they are building a direct relationship with the policy aides as well as the council mm-hmm. members themselves, so that we start to see more disability issues as platform issues when they're running for office. And I think still to this day, you don't see enough representation among city council members in understanding disability issues, in promoting disability issues, and then having staff that identify as having disabilities. And I think not only the advisory committee has a role with that, mm-hmm. but any city resident has a role with that.
Absolutely.
Whether they're an advocate or they're an individual with a disability, it's extremely mm-hmm. important that they make their voice heard.
And once again, if people have issues, accessibility issues, disability concerns, they should contact you, as you can direct them and to figure out how to get the resolution or a solution of some sort for that issue.
Yeah, I mean, essentially I want folks to know that if they contact me, they're not entering into this black hole where they don't know what the next action is,
mm-hmm.
that they're going to get a response in a timely manner, and that they're going to find out what is the next action or series of actions. So email address is guthrie.byard@minneapolismn.gov. So it's G-U-T-H. R-I-E, like mm-hmm. the theater, .byard, B as in Bravo, Y-A-R-D as in David, at MinneapolisMN.gov. And my phone number is 612-554-3666.
Great. Thanks so much for coming.
Yeah, you're welcome, John.
And look forward to hearing all the good things you're going to be doing for the city and for people with disabilities.
Yes, thank you.
Great. We'll be right back after these messages.
Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. My special guest today is Mai Thor, and we're going to talk today about disability justice. Hi, Mai, and welcome to the show. It's been a while since we've had you on.
Hi, Mark. Thank you. It's good to be back.
Thanks for being with us. So, disability justice, what is exactly disability justice?
Yeah, so disability justice is, I like to see it as an extension of the disability rights framework. And I think that framework, the disability rights framework, is what most people are probably familiar with, because as we know, throughout history, there's been a lot of advocacy and activism in the disability community that resulted in really great things, right? Including the ADA, Rehab Act, Olmstead, those kinds of things. The disability rights framework has no doubt been beneficial to disabled folks. But disability justice, on the other hand, is a little bit of a different perspective because it focuses more on the individual, right? Whereas disability rights doesn't so much.
That's a group effect. Yeah, it's a group effect.
Right, exactly. And so disability justice focuses on intersectionality, which is really a foundation of what it is. It focuses on, you know, the individual being whole, not disposable, being essential, and really recognizing disability as an identity.
Right.
You know, just the same as race and gender and economic status, those kinds of things.
So how did this movement start?
So the disability justice movement started back in the early 2000s, mainly in the Bay Area in California. And, you know, it started amongst a group of disabled queer women of color who, and that group exists, you know, sort of was leaders that were, you know, doing good work in the Bay Area already. So, you know, we're talking about like Mia Mingus and, who else was in a part of that? Now it's become, you know, other folks, you know, that expand beyond those women. But Stacey Milburn was a part of that also, the late Stacey Milburn. Those women, those disabled women of color were like, you know, the disability rights framework is great and it's done so much good, but it doesn't address, again, our intersectional needs, our intersectional identities. And so they were just sort of like, let's really like, you know, work on this and figure out how we can sort of create an extension of the disability rights framework that really addresses our marginalized and oppressed identities.
And what is ableism?
So ableism, you know, I talk about intersecting identities and how they're marginalized. And you can hold all of these identities while you still consider yourself a disabled person. Well, in my opinion, ableism really is the marginalization of our disabled identities, the oppression of our disabled identities. There's lots of different definitions out there. For example, Tia Lewis, who has been a longtime advocate and activist in the disability community, they say that a system of assigning value to people's bodies and minds based on societally constructed ideas of normality, productivity, desirability, et cetera, that's their take on what ableism is. But really, it's about oppression. You know, it's about marginalization. Right. And that really is based off of what we are, you know, physically, socially constructed to believe, what we can physically and you know, emotionally, how we perform.
There's,
you know,
a lot of different angles to it then, because people are at different levels in the disability community.
Yep.
And that's kind of how that works. The disability justice is rooted into 10 principles. What are these 10 principles of disability justice? And I might put a footnote to it here. We're going to go through these briefly today, but in future shows, I think we're going to open a special segment for this because these are important. So each one will be discussed in a little more depth in shows upcoming. So keep watching Disability Viewpoints and stay tuned. But what are those 10 principles?
Yep. So yeah, you're right. Disability justice is rooted in 10 principles. These principles really are, you know, the backbone of what this movement, this framework is. And this work is grounded in these 10 principles. And so I'll just list them real quick. One, you know, I've already mentioned intersectionality. Two is leadership of the most impacted. Three is anti-capitalism. Four is cross-movement solidarity. Five is wholeness. Six, sustainability. 7, cross disability solidarity, 8, interdependence,
right.
9, collective access, and the 10th one is collective liberation. And they all work together, Mark. They all are connected.
And what would you like to see changed or done? What is on your bucket list for these 10 principles?
I think one key takeaway that I've had while learning about the disability justice movement and how that was, you know, that how that was created and how other communities throughout the country are doing disability justice work is that it really needs to be rooted in community. And it really is a movement that is driven and cultivated and fostered by disabled folks. You know, we're always talking about, we're hearing about Crip culture and Crip history and all that good stuff. And that really is, that resonates with me so much because, you know, I think as disabled folks, we do have a hard time with that community aspect, right? And that we feel maybe siloed or a little isolated sometimes. But the disability justice movement really is all about community and having community shape what it looks like for your community.
Is this like the ADA? It'll celebrate 25 and 30 years. And what's the history of how long is this?
It is, but it's also about intentional work in a systemic way too, you know, because disability justice isn't just about creating good legislation and policy, which mainly has been what the disability rights movement has given us. It's also about really changing mindsets on how to commit to being anti-ableist and being able to call it out when you see it happening.
So what can be done to elevate the disability justice movement? What do you think we should do next?
Well, people can actually reach out directly to me, Mark, and I'll give you my email.
Can you give it twice? Because people might need to grab a paper and pencil and just your office number. I wouldn't give out your home number, just your office number. It's usually how we do it.
You know, I'm working remotely now, so yeah. I don't have a phone number, but I will share my email. It's house_of_solo@hotmail.com. And I'll spell that and I'll repeat it. HOUSE_OF_SOLO@hotmail.com. Again, HOUSE_of_SOLO@hotmail.com. And
okay.
I've been doing lots of really exciting work over the last couple of years here, trying to build capacity for creating a disability justice framework in Minnesota.
Great.
If folks are interested or just want to learn more, please feel free to contact me anytime.
Sounds good, and it's great to have you back on here.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you. Thanks for being here. We'll be back with more Disability Viewpoints in just a minute. Stay tuned.
Macular degeneration, glaucoma, cataracts, diabetic retinopathy. Every day, Minnesota seniors learn that they have one of these eye conditions, and suddenly they're struggling to live with vision loss.
Maybe that has happened to you.
Things that were once easy now seem hard or even impossible. Things you once enjoyed, like reading or cooking or playing cards, now seem like part of the past.
If vision loss is keeping you from living your life to the fullest, give State Services for the Blind a call. We have a team of low vision counselors who go out and meet with seniors in their homes. We'll talk to you about what is working and what is difficult. Then we'll provide you with practical tools and maybe a little bit of training to help you adjust to your vision loss and get back to doing the things you love.
We're here to help take the fear out of vision loss. All of this is at no cost to you, the consumer. It's paid for by the state of Minnesota. If you'd like to know more about how we can help, give us a call at 651-539-2300.
Well, that's our show for today. We hope that it was, we know it was a fast-paced half hour. And we hope you learned a lot at home as we did here. And disability justice was actually started in on the West Coast. But I mentioned to Mai Thor, there's no reason that Minnesota can't be a leader, as it usually always is. So if you have questions or anything related to disability justice, please email her. We've given that on the air, and we'll have her on in a future segment also on Disability Viewpoints. Joan, you had a great guest today.
Right. Guthrie Byard, the new communications specialist for the city of Minneapolis. And we learned a lot, and other cities should hopefully learn from this to be hiring someone who's going to manage many of the disability issues within especially a large city like Minneapolis. But the benefits of it are phenomenal, and so it's certainly fantastic to learn some of the good things he'll be doing for the city. And like I said, I hope other cities take a look at it and follow that model moving forward.
I have one quick announcement before we really go today. If any area who has the new enhanced Metro Mobility Taxi Program, it does work when you make your reservation, put your Metro Mobility number on it. But don't let them tell you that they can't use the wheelchair vans after 5 o'clock, because I had that issue, and I had to call down to the Met Council and get a coordinator to send those couple employees back to training. So they are working out some of the problems. And no ride is perfect, but I just want you to be aware. Don't ever let anybody on the phone tell you the wheelchair vans aren't available after 5 o'clock, because they are. So we'll talk to you soon. Thanks, Joan Willshire, for being here. I'm Mark Hughes on behalf of the SPNN staff and Joan Willshire and everybody here. I'm Mark Hughes. We'll see you again next time on Disability Viewpoints. Bye for now.